Greetings, Benjamin J. the Victrola Guy with another in the series. Well, this was an interesting acquisition. Pick this up dirt cheap. It is, of course, a floor model Columbia grafonola in really decent shape, as you can see. Haven't cleaned it up, haven't done anything to it yet except get it running. There was nothing physically wrong with it as far as the motor goes. The motor actually runs fairly well for having been sitting for the last 40 years. What happens on Columbia phonographs, they're notorious for this, the entire tone arm and support is made of pot metal. Everything on top of this machine, other than the motor, is made of pot metal. So the tone arm was completely frozen. I mean, it was just like that. It was immobile. You could not move it. You could put the arm on it and move it a bit, but it was frozen solid, as was the rest of the swivel. There's no bearings in this. It's made very much like a portable phonograph. It's just pot metal with two faces that are machine flat that are relatively friction free. The problem, of course, is all this stuff expands due to what's called intergranular degeneration. It's a phenomenon associated with pot metal. And pot metal is made of zinc and made of tin and lead. And so, what happens is moisture seeps actually into the pores of the metal. And when you have two dissimilar metals immersed in a liquid, you have a battery. And so, this thing begins to create electrolysis. And every moving part slowly expands, and freezes the machine solid. The only way you can hope to resurrect one of these things is if you can get these things apart. You can then take a file, file off the bearing surface, polish it, reassemble it, and the machine's up and running again. Unfortunately, in many cases, you'll try to disassemble this and it will just splinter. Pot metal, and you cannot drop it. It'll shatter like glass. So pot metal was great. It was an expedient. It worked really well. It's reasonably heavy duty and robust, but they weren't thinking 100 years down the road. So in any case, I picked it up really, really inexpensively, including the reproducer. And the reproducer was frozen in there as well. Now, the reproducer on the Columbia machine is a male mount, unlike the reproducer on the Victor machine. So this has a cutout for a detent. There's a spring-loaded detent in the bottom of the tone arm. And this snaps in, it's rotated, and that detent goes down into this groove, which locks the reproducer in position. So to install this reproducer, there's a cutout. You have to line up the cutout with the bottom of the tone arm, and it is a pain to get that detent to latch, but it did. You rotate it, the detent locks into its position, and there you have it. So I got the tone arm completely disassembled, got it apart, dressed down all the bearing surfaces, and it's now up and running. So we're going to play it. As soon as I find a needle. All right, so. And I picked this machine up for 50 bucks. So we install a needle. All right. This has a three-spring motor, and it's in really decent shape. I mean, it really is. It needs to be cleaned up. But as you see, it's in really nice shape. It also has the Columbia trademark louvers instead of doors. This became Columbia's exclusive trademark, so all the Columbia grafonolas have louvers rather than doors. All right, well, let's play this and see how it sounds. This is going to be the very first playing since I got the thing reassembled. I just wanted to do a video so you could hear it. And as I stress, don't overlook the junk. It took an hour and a half or so to get this machine running. It's been sitting for upwards of 40 years, I was told. So we start the motor, and it runs nice and quiet. All right, I've got my speed set, so let's see how it sounds. This is Billy Murray, Wait Till You Get Them Up in the Air.
Nothing you can do. You take her to a picture show where lights are always low. You start right into Bill and Co. and find it doesn't go. They fooled us ever since the world began. But listen, boys, I've got another plan. Wait till you get them up in the air, boys. Wait till you get them up in the air. You can make them hug and squeeze you too. For if they don't, just say you won't come down until they do. Wait till you get them up in the clouds, boys. There won't be anyone to watch you there. A parlor used to be the place where sweethearts loved to swoon. But nowadays you'll find that lover's lane is round the moon. So wait till you get them up in the air, boy. Up, 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 way up in the air. Now things have changed an awful lot since dear old grandma's day, when there were no cabarets. Canoes were all the craze. A lonely bench just built for two was all they wanted then. But nowadays the girls all seem to fool the awful men. When nights were bold, they fought for ladies fair. To win them now, they take them in the air. Wait till you get them up in the air, boys. Wait till you get them up in the air. You can sail along the Milky Way, and Mr. Mars will follow you to see you don't get gay. Wait till you get them up in the clouds, boys. There won't be anyone to watch you there. Romeo and Juliet love balconies, they say, but aeroplanes just built for two are all the rage today. So wait till you get them up in the air, boys. Up, 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 way up in the air.
So you see, it plays okay. It was definitely worth what I paid for. I had my trepidations about getting it fixed simply because it is so difficult to get these tone arms apart. The entire thing is made of pot metal. The entire thing. So, there's a spring ring that holds the tone arm to the stanchion. And if you can get that out, usually you can get the rest of it apart. It's really difficult, it's slow, tedious, and methodical, and once you get it apart, it takes about 10 minutes to fix it. Just a few strokes with a file to reduce the diameter where it has expanded, and it's back in business and in perfect working condition. A few drops of oil, and this is good for another 100 years. So I did some basic lubrication on the motor, the friction pads, and don't really know what I'm going to do with it yet. It's in really decent shape, like I said. It's got a few minor glitches in it. One little tiny piece of missing vernier there. A couple of dings and dents. But other than that, for being the age of the machine and the fact that it hadn't run for 40 plus years, I mean, literally, that's what they said. It had been sitting in their grandmother's house or basement or attic or someplace for the last 40 years. And of course, when they tried to get it to run, they couldn't get the tone arm to move. So when you have a phonograph that's that badly damaged, it's virtually worthless unless you're willing to put the time and the energy into it. And if you break it, all you can do is replace it. So, you know, as I say, don't overlook the junk. If you're good with your hands, you can fix 99% of all the problems on an acoustic phonograph. That's just a matter of doing it. It's not particularly difficult, it's time-consuming, it's dirty, it's frustrating sometimes. But the result, you know, an hour and a half's work, and I have a new Columbia Grafonola, as you can see, in fairly decent condition. And it's completely original. It hasn't been touched at all. So, it was interesting to get it. Whether I could get it working or not, I didn't know. But I did, which is gratifying. So, now it's just a matter of what do I do with it. It's in decent shape. It sounds good. It plays good. It needs to run. This is the first day that it's run in the last 40-plus years. So, not really sure, but just wanted to do a quick video so you could see it. It's an interesting machine. It's nothing like a Victor machine. Completely different kind of machine. And in my opinion, it's not made nearly as well. The motor is built like a tank, but as far as everything on the top end is, they made it the cheapest way they possibly could. And it works, but unfortunately, since it's made of pot metal, once it swells, this machine is never going to play again unless you can get it apart and physically reduce the dimensions of the swollen parts. But it was a challenge, and in this case, it worked out rather well. It was worth the money. Nice-looking phonograph. Sounds okay. So, as again, I just now need to decide what it is I'm going to do with it. But I wanted to do a quick video on it. So, as always, if you have any questions, feel free to drop an email to victrolaguy@gmail.com. Answer all of my email. I'll try to answer it the day I get it. But it was a fun couple of hours, and it was problematical. I didn't know if I could fix it or not. But in this case, I did. So, as always, if you have any questions, feel free to drop me an email, thevictrolaguy@gmail.com. And as always, thank you for watching.